Well, good afternoon, everybody. Whew. Is that loud enough? Can you hear me? All right. Let's go ahead and get started. I know there's still maybe some people coming in shortly. What I wanted to do, I wanted to give you a couple of update areas and then answer some questions. Some got emailed in. Some actually relate to some of the updates I wanted to give anyway. And then I wanted to take some time to allow people that are here today to share any good information, any information about awards or recognitions or something great that you think everybody ought to know about that I think would be useful. And then we'll just open the floor to questions if there are any. Been spending more time than I'd like to at the legislature. It's that time of year. It's a little crazy down there this year, especially with the state of the budget. And there's a lot of new members, so it takes a little bit longer to get through some things. Of interest to you, it looks like we're going to take another 1% cut for this fiscal year. And that's because the solvency package that the legislature presented to the governor, she vetoed some provisions in there. And if the state's cash reserves fall below 2%, then they're going to basically do a 1% across the board cut to everybody. She vetoed enough things that it falls below 2%. So most likely there's another 1% cut happening this year. What we've budgeted in contingency is definitely more than that amount of money. So we shouldn't have to look at any of our budgets for this year. Next year, it might be another story though. Next year's budget is still up in the air. We've started the hearings down there. They're gonna do a new revenue forecast on February the 16th. We had our first higher education budget hearing in Senate Finance this week on Tuesday. We have our first hearing in the House Appropriations and Finance Committee on February the 14th. They will probably start with the lowest recommended numbers in those budgets and then adjust based upon whatever that revenue forecast looks like that will come out somewhere. I think right now they're planning on the 16th of February. Sometimes that's a moving target. Our budget for next year could be anywhere from a few thousand dollars increase to a 5% cut. Very hard to pick. I'm gonna sort of say we're gonna probably think in our planning process on a 3% cut and hope it's less. If we can plan for 3% and it's less, that'd be great. A couple things that are going on down there. They're probably gonna have to cut another or have $300 million less next year to spend than they have this year. Partially they gotta get the reserves back up, and then partially there's a revenue shortfall of about $127 million. So we think that they're going to have to figure out how to make up about $300 million worth of either shortfall or cuts because of lower revenues coming in. The positive news is that the Senate Finance Committee, a lot of the conversation related to, well, maybe we've been too hard on higher education. It came from them, not from us. That was nice. But I don't know what they can do about it in a lot of ways, because we're about, higher education is about 16, 17% of the state's non-federal budget. And when you add us with public schools, we're well over 50% of the state's budget. And then a lot of the state's budget is entitlement programs, and they can't really cut those. So when they have to do major cuts, it's really hard not to impact education, both at the public school level and the higher education level. But at least we think they're at least talking about how do we minimize that, even if we do have to take some more cuts. So we'll keep you posted on that. Some of the other legislation that's flowing through, and there's a lot of it, but of interest, I think, to those of us here. There was a hearing this morning. There's two bills related to articulation and transfer of college credits. We're very excited about it as a community college because it might make the universities take courses that sometimes they aren't so easy about taking. It also relates to the work that's going on to come up with the common course numbering, to come up with revisions to the gen ed requirements, and to come up with some suggested meta majors for around the state. So although some of that is left open in the legislation, it gives the backing of legislation to help us with that. And I actually had two students from my past who are at the legislature today because of those bills, one of whom is actually suing one of the universities because they are not accepting her credits and transfer. So it was kind of an interesting morning down there with that. But that's one we're looking at. And then there's a few bills that relate to elections. And it's There's a 250-page bill that you go to sleep reading that is looking at combining all elections in the state into the off years when there's not statewide or federal elections. And so in the years in which there's a statewide election, they would stay the same. They may combine, if it happens, it would combine all municipal elections, all public school elections, all community college elections, all conservation district elections into one election, either in October or November. And there's some, that part we're not so concerned about. There's some parts into how you would pay for those elections and how they would tax us for those, and they would tax us about an amount three times more than we've ever paid for an election that we did totally on our own. So we're trying to get some of those provisions changed. But those are the ones that worry us. There's a lot of bills and memorials both out there that are being proposed that would have we would have to do some work without getting funded to do. Unbudgeted mandates, that's what it is, unbudgeted mandates. So we have to keep an eye on those because they always crop up. Something sounds like a great idea, but until they start asking people about it, they don't realize, what it would take to do that. There's some that would take, we'd have to have staff here and staff at the Higher Education Department just to report on things that we don't really do, but we'd have to collect data for. So always an interesting process at the legislature. If you've never been down there, you should go someday. You might want to think about going. February 27th is going to be Community College Day at the legislature. That's also the Academic All-Star Day, where all the students from the two-year schools who are being recognized by Phi Theta Kappa chapters will get recognized and honored and have some special events there. And we'll have a table in the rotunda for Santa Fe Community College, as well as the other independent community colleges, and maybe SunPath. They're talking about it. Okay, good. So that's it on the legislature, unless you have questions on the legislature. Yeah?
Is there anything about lottery scholarships?
There's a lot of movement on the lottery scholarships. Don't know what's going to happen. It's got shored up this year and the last several years with moving the liquor excise tax. That sunsets this year. There has been a request made to try to extend that one more year while they put together a group to try to make recommendations. That's not going to happen because they've already borrowed that money and spent it somewhere else this year. So there will be some changes to the lottery scholarship. The Secretary, Davron of the Higher Education Department, and most of us from the 2 and 4 year schools have been advocating for a task force to come up with recommendations. And so there's everything's being considered from just leaving it as it is and only reimburse whatever percentage is available, to changing it to a need-based program totally, to changing it to a fixed amount that is given to the student and let them pick where to go. That would be good for us because they might take more, we don't have that many lottery scholarship students. I think it's about 300. I don't know if anybody else can confirm that, but it's about 300. Most of the lottery scholarship students go to the four-year schools. And of course, they've quadrupled their tuition over the last 20 years, which is what's killed the lottery scholarship fund. And, for a variety of reasons, they've had to raise their tuition. So, I made a recommendation to one legislator, well, just give 100% to people who go to two-year colleges and give it less to four-year. But we'll see where that goes. I'm a little prejudiced. I told him that. So anyway, any other questions on the legislature?
Uda?
Yeah, so the governor made a recommendation in her budget that 3.5% of the contribution to the ERB, RPERA, whichever one you're in, be moved from the employer to the employee. The governor's still talking about that. That would mean a cut and take home pay for everybody. The legislature, I don't believe, is even going to consider that. So we've all been down there talking to them, and we've actually said, and I've said it to some of our legislators, if you need to cut that amount of money, just cut that amount of money out of our budget. Let us figure out where to take the cuts. Don't mandate that it come on the backs of our employees. I don't think that will go anywhere, but we're keeping our eye on it. But as of right now, the legislators and the committees say won't even discuss it. So it's not on the table as far as they're concerned. Anybody else in the legislature? Okay. We had our board meeting, our monthly board meeting last week. Just a couple of things I think that'd be interesting to everybody. We still are seeing slight declines in enrollment, but actually our head count is up this spring over last spring. It's our student credit hours are down about 2%. Remember, we budgeted, we thought we might be down as much as 6% this year. We're still down less than what we had budgeted and anticipated. It seems to be flattening out a little bit. The fact that our head count is up and our credit hours is down actually is kind of a good sign, because it means more of our, we have more students, but if they're working, they're taking less credit hours. And we know that over 70% of our students go part-time. So I want to thank Marcos, Daniela, and all the people in recruitment. We've done a lot of new initiatives. We're still registering people for this spring. There's still some dual credit classes, I believe, that aren't in the system. There's still some late starting courses. So we actually may be a little bit better off even than we are today compared to last spring. We also approved, as everybody knows, the process is ongoing for full-time faculty to consider forming a union or a collective bargaining agreement with the college. As part of that whole process, the college does have a resolution that created a Santa Fe Community College Labor Management Relations Board. It was never constituted because we never had any union agreements or collective bargaining agreements in place. So the board at the in December at a special meeting approved our recommendation to be on that three-member board. Labor put forward a name, and it was approved at the last board meeting, to be the second person on that three-member board. And now those two members get together and come up with a third, somewhat neutral party that they will recommend to our governing board. So we're hoping that that third name will come forward and be approved at the February 20th board meeting. By the way, the board meeting in February is on a Monday instead of a Wednesday this time. And then we'll be able to fully constitute the Santa Fe Community College and Labor Management Relations Board. Right now, we're operating under the auspices of the State Public Employees Labor Management Relations Board. And our resolution and our rules that will be adopted will mirror what the state does. But that's the happening there. And then, as all of us probably know, we continue to work on policies. That includes the board. And so at this last board meeting, there were five policies that were up and went through final reading, and one for retirement. And there were six policies that were up for first reading this time around. So that continues there. Related to the board, remind you that there is an election. If you haven't voted already, early voting is available here on campus, right next to the cashier's office. Through this Saturday, it's from 8 to 5, Monday through Saturday. And then next week is actually election day on Tuesday. So if you don't vote early, you'd have to go to one of your polling places. And you can actually go to any polling places this time, and they'll print a ballot just like they do at the early voting site. So you don't have to drive across town if you get over here and forget you didn't vote before you got this far. But just a reminder, we have one board position up with two candidates. It's a combined election with Santa Fe Public Schools. They have two board positions that are up. Neither one of their positions have opposition, so there is one person races, but there is a $100 million bond election up for the public schools. So if you haven't voted and you're registered in this community, I'd encourage you to vote. On the collective bargaining side, so I know one of the questions that came in was about this. In addition to our governing board approving labor's recommendation to sit on our Labor Management Relations Board, the process is continuing on. There's not a whole lot I can say about it, other than where we are in the process right now is coming to some kind of agreement on who is or is not eligible to be part of the collective bargaining agreement, and setting a date for which those who are eligible to vote will vote. And right now what they'll be deciding on is, are they going to form a collective bargaining agreement with the AAUP as their agent, or are they do not want to form an agreement at this time. That's the only two choices. It's looking like the election will be the last week of March. The final date has not quite been set yet. It's still being worked out, and that'll be noticed around campus as soon as that is settled there. Any questions on that issue? All right. Share some good news. What kind of awards students, faculty, staff have received, or great news that you want to share? I know we have a couple of these to announce in here. Somebody better remember what they are. Yeah, come on.
Jake from Welding, Lovato, last Thursday received the Regional American Welding Society Educator of the Year Award.
All right, yay. Related to that, I don't think anybody from the foundation is in here. You know, the college through the foundation has been partnering with the Guns for Gardens project, the gun buyback. And so both Jake from Welding and John Boyce and others from the art department have been working, and we will be making garden tools and art out of melted guns that were purchased during the buyback. And there will be an event held here on campus, I believe it's in early May. May 6th, and it'll be a fundraising event. There'll be an auction. Jake Lovato, not only is he the Educator of the Year, but he's also a licensed auctioneer. And so there's going to be an auction with, I think, paddles and everything to try to get people to buy some of the things that are being made by the art department and the welding department. And I'm not going to give anything away, but I think there's going to be some unique fashion items for you to look at. So save up some money between now and May 6th. Okay. Other announcements, recognitions we'd like to share.
Yep. I'm moving forward on the first day of mental health, and we are going to partnership with CYFD to bring that to the campus. And we will have the dates for those, which is February 24th, March 31st, and April 28th. And Kate and I are working to get that set up, and we're also going to work with Jeff, so you'll be able to sign up for it in Banner. It won't be any cost to you. It's an all-day training. And it will be on Friday, so hopefully everyone will be able to send them in their area. Our goal is to try to get two people from every department to try and take it on this go-around, and then continue this process, because I also believe we have a faculty member in health sciences, Yuri, that's going to get trained, so once he comes on board, too, we can continue the training on him.
This is a great training, so I'd like for many of you, and especially those in every department, I'd like to make sure that we do have at least a couple of people that do get trained, so try to work schedules so you can figure out a time. You know, mental health issues, we're dealing with them every day on campus. We're dealing with them every day throughout our community. And so the more we can learn about the issues related to that, how to approach it, how to actually assess whether something is occurring or not, and then who to go to. We're not expecting to train you to be the problem solver, but you do need to learn how to be the person that helps with the assessment, brings in the appropriate resources, and how to deal with people that are having those issues. And as many of you know, we've had a couple of them over the last 2 weeks that were quite public, so I will not go into detail about them, but some of you were observers of those. So anyway, what else? Yeah,
Marcos. Office of Recruitment and Outreach hosted Capital High School Junior Day, Capital High School Senior Day this past Monday and Tuesday. Last year we started this in regards to these open houses for these different high schools. So far we worked with Santa Fe High School Juniors and Seniors, Pecos High School Juniors and Seniors, now Capital High School Juniors and Seniors, giving us a grand total of over more than 400 students that have come into these doors to meet with faculty, staff, and to see our tremendous facilities. So we're very proud of that.
All right, great job, great job. For those of you who weren't over in the main hallway today, when I came back from the legislature, I thought, well, I know I was gone a long time, but our students got a lot younger. But it was great to see all the younger students here from the elementary schools, and I think middle schools, too. Were they middle schools or just elementary schools, too?
They don't seem to be getting shorter, though.
No, they're not. But it was great to see the science fair exhibits and the robots running up and down the halls. So that was kind of fun to watch. If you missed it, you missed something. What else we could share? Nick?
Just wanted to let everybody know that as of yesterday, our audit was released by the state auditor. So it's official. The college removed 7 findings from last year, if you remember. We fixed all of those outstanding findings. We have 2 for this current audit, and they're very minor. And so the good news is everything we knew about, we had remedied last time around. And so our audit is complete. And so that's really good news for all grants and things like that. The college moved from what was designated in there as a high-risk entity to a low-risk entity, so that's something.
And the thanks especially goes to the financial services area, but it really goes to all of you, because a lot of our findings related to the way we were tracking things, the way we were purchasing things, a whole variety of things. And so everybody has really come together over the past few years to help improve our systems and our processes that's helped us to get to this point. So this is very important for us. Jeff, you had?
Yeah. The Professional Development Fund has money available. We're taking applications for that. It's basically a grant application to get money to go to a conference or to hire somebody to come here and teach. Deadline is March 1st, and then the committee will meet March 10th, and we'll move on and give away money. So think about it.
Give away money. I like that.
It's fun.
Yeah.
So I'm Sandy, and I work in the testing center. If those of you don't know me, but this has absolutely nothing to do with the testing center. It has everything to do with the Gerald Clay Memorial Basketball tournament that's coming up March 3rd, March 4th. We need people who want to be a team, and you don't have to be good. In fact, really, that was so much longer. This is an opportunity for us to raise money for a scholarship in Gerald's name. Everybody who's known him misses him terribly. I'm coordinating the volunteers. I need timekeepers, scorekeepers. I need somebody to push a mop around a basketball court. And I need good energy, and we're doing it all day on Friday and Saturday. And so I'm, call me, 1508. 1508. That's my extension, okay? 1508.
Thank you, Sandy. I encourage people to participate. They tried to talk me into doing a one-on-one with another celebrity who was a lot younger than me, and I said I didn't think that was a good idea. Rebecca.
For those of you who don't know me, I'm Rebecca Stella. One of my hats is with the Higher Education Center Executive Director, and we are now in a position to officially announce in fall 2017 we are rolling up 3 new partners. The ink is dry on Seattle Film Institute, which has a lot to do with Monique Adair's efforts. It was an articulation agreement that was already in place. They will be offering classes on our campus face-to-face. The other, which is an in-state institution, is Northern New Mexico College. As of Monday, we basically, as soon as we finalize and update a couple of things, we'll have 5 programs face-to-face at the HEC. Computer science, engineering, psychology, nursing, and project management. The nursing, for those of you who are familiar with our New Mexico Nursing Education Consortium, because Northern is outside of that, this gives other students who have chosen not to do the RN to BSN directly another option, or even those who maybe got an RN prior to that partnership are able to come back and get that BSN, so it's just another option. And then the other one is Bellevue University, which is actually it's their main campus is out of state. They're a private nonprofit. They'll all be online, although they will be hiring someone from the community of Santa Fe to be the on-site recruiter, coordinator, advisor. So that job will eventually post probably in the fall. The nice thing about them is along with having transfer scholarships set aside for students, they are also putting scholarship money aside. It's one of the things we got to work out for staff and faculty who want to take any courses there as well. So we're figuring it out as we go.
Good job.
One of the nice things about Bellevue and another college that we haven't finalized things with now is that they are looking at more of, you know, normally when you articulate it's a 2+2 model, 2 years at the community college and 2 years at the four-year school. There are some that are looking at almost a 3+1 model, which allows students to take more classes at Santa Fe Community College at our tuition rates before transferring over to finish up at those institutions at their tuition rates, which are always higher. So we're hoping that that's an opportunity for faculty and staff to work on degrees, especially for staff who may not have a bachelor's degree yet, but also to take advantage of those tuition funds that Bellevue has set aside for that purpose.
That's awesome.
And for graduate programs too, right, okay. So that, one of the questions that came in related to that, the only piece of the question that came in that Rebecca didn't know about is that who's in and who's out was the question. The only program or college that's not in, that's been at the HEC is IAIA. They tried for years, they really couldn't get anything to work at the Higher Education Center. They're our neighbor out here and we continue to work with them. But New Mexico Highlands is still our largest partner.
They've added cohorts. They also added a master's in social work. They grew from five dedicated classrooms to eight this academic.
And then we still have UNM and New Mexico State, but their programs are, I think, 100% online or via ITV.
NMSU still would like to figure out how to do the hotel restaurant
right.
management in person. What we're running into is they schedule the classes and they've been canceling for low enrollment.
So we're continuing to work on trying to figure out how to buttress that, but yes, UNM is all online. Great. We do have UNM representation, though, over there for advising and recruiting and those sorts of purposes, the first and third Thursday of every month, 9 a.m.
Thank you. All right.
So, Randy, our students have what's called Student Voice Review next Thursday. Mm-hmm. So faculty, what a great opportunity for our students to really to come and talk with Randy about what they want to see at Santa Fe Community College, what are some opportunities that students can look at and say, hey, Randy, this is what we're thinking about. Potentially we'll have the mayor there as well. It's a facilitation process where we gather this information and then we present it over to Randy. And therefore, so I think it's a great opportunity for your faculty folks to bring your students. Believe it or not, there's food as usual for your students and you guys. So it's 12 to 2. And it's all in three hemispheres. Okay. It's a facilitation process. Right. Okay.
For me.
I want to acknowledge Mr. Kerry Thompson back here and David Keppel for upgrading a 10-year-old critical piece of
see all the work that they do, because oftentimes they're doing it weekends and off hours, because they have to do their systems when we're not using them mostly. So it was great to come in. I caught them eating burritos when I came in, but the consultant was hard at work, so that was good. That was hard at work.
Next time, have an extra burrito when I, just in case I show up, okay? It was great. Anybody else? Okay. Well, I got some questions that came in. Here was one. Can you give up an update on the flooding that occurred on campus, and is there any mold? First of all, there is no mold. For mold, you have to have standing stagnant water for a period of time. And we caught this leak within probably the first hour of it occurring. The insurance company came in, provided the renovation folks
to do things. We've just gotten our first estimate. Looks like it's between $90,000 and $100,000 worth of
damage between equipment, ceiling, tiles, having to replace sheetrock, a variety of things. So that process for replacing the sheetrock that needs to be replaced will be starting here pretty soon?
Within the next few weeks.
Okay, within the next few weeks. So a lot of hard work. Thank Safety and Security for finding the leak so fast. And thanks to plant operations and maintenance and the custodial staff and IT staff who came in very quickly. It happened on the Friday we were closed for the snow day, so there weren't as many people around, which means it could have the flood could have gone a lot longer. We got really lucky to find it. But even so, a lot of water got around. So here's another one. Can you give us an update on our status as a sanctuary school and its potential impact on us with federal funds? And what support can we offer and receive from the city and what challenges may we face? Just a reminder, the board did approve a sanctuary campus resolution at the November 30th board meeting. It basically states our values, and it basically states that we're going to do everything we can within the law. Our lawyers wouldn't let us say we were going to break the law. So it does say we will do everything we can legally. It is still unknown what repercussions we might suffer as a result of doing this. You know, I know that the new administration has threatened to take away federal funds from cities that are sanctuary cities. We will have to keep on top of this. We will have to potentially make some tough decisions because, you know, federal funds are not only support us for grants and different programs, but also federal financial aid. And so we will keep on top of what might be facing us. And if we have to either change what we want to do or if we have to stick up for our values, how are we going to get through it without harming our students especially? Don't know what that means at this point in time. Those of you, either way you believe, I recommend you get involved and get engaged and be part of the discussion and part of the decisions that are made. But we have no official notifications related to that at this point in time. Okay. Well, it depends on which side you're on. But, you know, just get involved. There is a combination of city, county, and local nonprofit entities who are really involved in the sanctuary status, the protection of rights for immigrants. Most of that's being read by Somos en Pueblos. And so if you can get on their mailing list or go to their website, there are meetings that happen in conjunction with the city and the county. And we will be and have been involved in some of those. Unfortunately, the ones they've had lately have been at really bad times for us as a college. But there are groups out there, and I know there's probably groups that are on the other side of the picture too. But this community and really this state seems to be on the side of fairness and giving people access and treating people equitably, and we'll just have to monitor the situation as we go forward. Every day I'm a little surprised at what happened that day and moving forward, so we'll see. Ernest?
Randy, we're going to look at hosting a workshop or discussion for students to be proactive instead of reactive if and when this might happen, so students aren't looking at other students and saying this or that. How can we really have real conversation, healthy conversation around, you know, change if it happens? So we're looking to host that. We're working with ideas. So people want to check in with us
as soon as an institution of higher education, those are incredible conversations to be having on campus. And so where appropriate, when you have group meetings, when you have clubs, even if it's appropriate in some classes, I mean, there's lots of opportunity to have assignments related to current events these days. And I encourage those conversations, and we have to do everything respectfully. But the college
values are such that we do want to respect the rights of our immigrant population, and we will do whatever we can to protect their privacy and make sure that the campus is a safe place to the best ability we can at this point. Okay. Any other questions on that? Okay. Yep.
Yeah.
And not just for the students that I have talked to, they're more worried about their family members necessarily than they are about themselves. But some of the students, and actually many of the students we have, wouldn't be impacted, but they might lose their family members. And that's a great impact on students. So we'll see what happens
in that respect. Okay? All right. That one we talked about. One other thing was what's the latest with the Meow Wolf collaboration? We're working very closely with Meow Wolf. It's still a moving target, but we have 21 students from Meow, artists affiliated with Meow Wolf taking classes this semester. They're generating over 90 or around 90 credit hours. 93, you got it from the correct number. Over 90 is what I was going to say. Credit hours. And it's great, and it's a project in which Meow Wolf itself is going to pay for 50% of the tuition and fees for its employees or associates, I think they call them over there, that come here. And then we've been working to raise funds to cover the other half, kind of like a scholarship. And there's a lot of things that we're looking at that could be a long-term project. For this semester alone, we have outside private funding to cover the other half of the tuition. We think it's a great opportunity. And, you know, I've talked to their CFO and with Vince, who's the head of Meow Wolf. They're sending people over who are already artists in their own right, but to come and learn business skills, to learn marketing skills, to learn skills maybe in media arts when they're, you know, more of a visual art or a traditional arts background program. So it's really great because our goal in working with Meow Wolf is that Meow Wolf is getting demand to replicate itself at other cities. They want to do as much of that work from Santa Fe as opposed, and then just build the facility there and have to hire local people to run the facilities there. And in a meeting I had downtown with some business people who are actually contributing to this fund, they said, we want Santa Fe to be known as the home of Meow Wolf, not the birthplace of Meow Wolf. Because too many times in New Mexico, things start here and go. So anyway.
So the paper talked about a manufacturing facility. Has that entered into the conversation?
Correct. So what they're going to be doing, they're designing new sets for what they do in their own place, but if they're going to expand to Los Angeles, Denver, I mean, they've got major opportunities in other places. They'd like to design them and maybe even manufacture a lot of it here and then ship it there. That's jobs for New Mexico. We want that, if at all possible, to do that. So it's fun. We need jobs. We need jobs. I got handed another question. It says, why were there no faculty senate or staff senate representatives on the committee who developed the master plan? I don't know if we've asked faculty or staff senate to represent because those were open meetings. So we invited certain types of people we knew who would be involved in that master plan. There is a meeting, is it tomorrow? Tomorrow at 2:00, open to anybody who wants to come to review what the consultant's final recommendations are. Based upon that, we'll have some feedback. They will probably update that master plan. And remember, we're just doing an update to the current master plan, not a whole new master plan, and that will be presented to the board on the February 20th, at the February 20th board meeting, and then hopefully that will be the basis for the board to make a decision to go out or not go out for a bond election. And so we're tentatively hoping that decision will be made at the May board meeting for possibly an early August election for bonds and or a mill levy, if we decide to go for both of those or not. Well, those people that have been coming to those meetings, they've been sharing overviews. I don't know if it's anywhere on the website or not. And where is the meeting?
Well, for every workshop, and this will be the sixth workshop, the plan's handed out and updated at every workshop. So most folks have been attending or their representatives bring that copy to the next meeting, and that copy is put in a new copy of the updated plan. So for all intents and purposes, one member of the executive team has been familiar with this project since its inception. We've had, I think, 15 open presentations for 6 months on this master plan thing, and we've done numerous invitations to those folks, so we tried to capture as much as we did as we can. We had a live survey online for 2 months. We've just about done everything we can to get input.
And where is the meeting tomorrow?
The meeting is tomorrow at 2:00 in the boardroom, and we'll give a final workshop presentation. Of course, we've had a number of workshops throughout the past 6 months. But there's definitely an opportunity at this workshop to bring up any information, any considerations you like, or any suggestions you like to make. It's still open.
Just remember,
this is an update, so it's a pretty high-level plan, not the nitty-gritty of we're going to put carpet in this room and not this room, and chairs in this room and not this room. So that comes in other ways, but this is really what do we need in terms of any new facilities, in terms of major infrastructure upgrades, in terms of remodeling. One of the things that we're looking very closely at is to do some major upgrades to the fitness center. It's been a while since we've done major upgrades, both on equipment and for that, and we think that's real important because the people who use the fitness center do vote. And so we want for them to have a reason to vote for our bond election if we have one. So it'll probably be spelled out in there. Yeah, Patty?
What's the status on the new road that's supposed to be built on campus?
Good question. My understanding is moving forward. We do have to pay for half of the extension of College Drive from where it currently ends, where you can enter into the campus, to wherever that Southeast Connector Road is. It is my understanding that in the election bond items that are on the ballot in November, it included the funding to actually build the road. All they had before was the funding to design it. So it is my understanding they do now have the funds not only for design, but for actual construction. Now, when they're going to start, that's another question. They had said late 17. We're in 17, and they haven't completed, as far as I know, haven't completed all the design work yet. So it does look like it's still going to be at the eastern end of our campus. And I do know there was a challenge because Rabbit Road basically was going to be extended right along the freeway up to Richards Avenue, not in like it is now where it runs into Oshar, but more like a frontage road adjacent to I-25. The feds were going to pay for that. The feds pulled out. So the state and the county have to come up with it. And my understanding is that those two projects have to go together because one feeds the other. So I haven't heard any anything lately, and I've not seen that they've had any public meetings on it lately. So as soon as we hear anything, we'll share it with you. Okay. And I don't, and I'm sure it would take 12 to 18 months to construct once they build it. I do know, though, from a conversation I had the other day, originally they weren't going to put utilities along the road, but now my understanding is they're looking at potentially doing all utilities, water, power, and maybe even cable fiber. Which would be good news, just in case. But that's also an extra cost.
And how is that going to impact the ropes course?
It's way the other side of the ropes course. It's on the eastern boundary of the college campus. And, of course, the college campus goes way east of the ropes course.
It's actually right there, outside the property line.
Yeah. So, I mean, remember, there was one proposal originally where it would come in right real close to the ropes course and cut our property in half. That's gone. So now it's the far eastern boundary. The question is, will they have money to pay for not only, well, they don't have to worry about paying for College Drive to be extended because Rancho Viejo Partnership and Santa Fe Community College have to pay for that. But they're also looking at Avenue to Del Sur, right?
Yes.
The one south of here, running it from Richards over there so that people, you know, that live south of here could come down that Southeast Connector Road and over, get some more traffic off of Richards Avenue. That's really the real goal of that. So. So the county approved the apartment, but the apartment can't be built until there's a road. So it's on hold until there's a road. That's one way of getting around saying that we didn't not approve the apartment complex. Because there was a lot of politics related to that. Yeah. So I don't know where that stands in terms of the developers and their funding and whether they're still waiting or are going to move forward when the road is built or not. But as far as I know, it's still planned.
Okay.
Right, so we've estimated our cost, and so part of our master plan will include that because we do have to come up with the funds to pay for that. And the odds of getting money from the state to help us with capital outlay are almost negative this year, and we don't know what they're going to ask us for money. And we're not sure what it's going to look like next year. Next year is the GO bond election, and so that's usually when it goes to the voters. And so we will be asking for more money than we normally have for the state GO bond because that's just what goes to the voters is approved by the legislature, does not have to be approved by the voters. But then it goes to the voters, and the voters have to approve it. And so we'll be part of a statewide election, which we have never really asked for a lot of money. By statute, community colleges have to put up at least 25% of a project, and the state can put up 75%. New Mexico Santa Fe Community College has always done the opposite. We've put up 75%, or sometimes 100%, and not gotten as much money from the state, partially because we have a very stable tax base in the Santa Fe area. So we're not like some of the rural communities that don't have much of a tax base, or where they have the oil and gas, and they're up and down and up and down. You know, we're pretty stable in Santa Fe, which is a positive for us. So.
We don't need to fight with the
world. No. Yeah.
When's the next time that the master plan will be updated?
We usually try to update it every 5 years. We're a little past the 5 years this time. I think the last... Yeah. Well, we have to update things that we report to higher education department. Every year, we give them a rolling five-year update. But the true document itself, which is a college document, the last time the board approved, I think it was 2009. Okay. So, and we're not doing a whole brand new plan. We're just doing an update to that existing plan.
And so the next time there will be this process will be 5 years from now?
It could be sooner, but it has to be at least 5 years from now. But we do one every year, though, because of the legislative requirements.
Okay.
Right. So every year we have to turn in a five-year plan and a one-year priority to the state for our either severance tax bond request or our GO bond request. And, of course, if we go out for our own election, we still have to get those approved by the state, too. Okay. Anything on that one? Okay. The last question I have here, and then I'll open to the floor, says when physical plant funds are allocated for small projects like chairs in a computer lab, why is there no process that is similar to the way technology advisory committee funds are allocated with proposals being submitted and then ranked? We don't do it the same way we do TAG, but we have had a process where we went through and everybody reviewed everything. We have a whole list of about $10 million worth of projects that range from chairs in a computer lab to carpeting upgrades to a whole variety of things. And so they're all on this master list that the governing board has approved. We did get a lot of input around campus from that. We've taken that, I'm pretty sure we took that even through shared governance process for feedback. Obviously, you know, things change from day to day. When something breaks, we have to fix it. And so we don't always get to go exactly down that process. Sometimes priorities change, and so something that was a high priority here and it was scheduled for 2 years from now, you know, something may come in and bump it down the way or even replace it at some point in time because, you know, our needs change every year. Some of the things we've done with computer labs have happened because we now have the technology fee. So the students are paying $2 per credit hour for a technology fee, can only go support technology projects that benefit the students. So we just updated a new Mac lab, or not a new Mac lab, we upgraded an existing Mac lab, right? And we're getting ready to do some work on the wireless infrastructure. Is that right?
That's correct, yes.
Okay.
And in fact, we just bought new chairs for it.
And we just bought new chairs for that lab because we did that. So that may be where the question came from. But anyway, so it may not look like it, but there's processes behind just about everything, because we have to.
Checks and balances.
Right. And everything has to be submitted to the Higher Education Department and the Department of Finance Administration before we can spend a dollar. So they ask some of these questions, and they're focused more on the making sure we have the money for it. So, yeah. Well, that's all the questions that came in either in writing or via email. Any other questions while we're here? Yes, are there new employees are here? Chris, you're here. Stand up and introduce yourself. Some of you know Chris Swedeen and some probably don't.
Hello, I'm Chris Swedeen. I worked here a while back. I think in 2006 to 2008. And I'm Director of Continuing Education and Contract Training. And we're going to all work together again, which is very exciting. And we are going to start working on our kids' stuff in our summer program soon. And so if any of you want to teach in the summer or have a really wonderful idea, we are available to take your ideas and to turn them into something fabulous.
Chris, welcome back. Welcome.
Anybody else here today that's new? Well, great. I know we have new people just about every day. It seems like there's somebody new that's here. But I want to thank everybody for all you do. Making a difference for our students and our community is really important. I want to once again thank especially the pond staff, the ground staff. I know it's been warm the last few days, but we've had a few of those snow days and a few icy days and a few floods on campus that they've had to deal with and campus security. Please thank those people that actually do a lot of behind-the-scenes work that you don't see, whether it's OIG, whether it's plant operations maintenance, safety, and security. They're always here for us, and
their jobs are pretty tough, and we don't always know about them. I've been surprised as I've moved up in my jobs here that now where I see and hear about just about everything that happens on campus is kind of shocking.
It's shocking until you realize we're a small city.
Right.
You know, with 800 to 1,000 employees and 13 to 15,000 students out here every semester, we're like a small community. And, you know, things happen, as we all know. And so I thank all of you for doing a good job of keeping things in place. So, okay. All right. Did you have a question? Comment?
I had a comment. Mm-hmm. Maybe it's a little bit more of a bit of an announcement while there's hi, everyone. I wanted to just put it out there that if any of you see an opportunity to externally voice or show up for any of our undocumented communities, I was at a town hall meeting yesterday, and as was Jennifer, advocating for different things, but there were many members of our student population there and their families. Discussing some really difficult things, and including their experiences, their fears, and in ways in which they've been targeted right here in Santa Fe, which is not something, I'm not bringing it up to emphasize that so much as to say, like, I think it's really meaningful, any instance where they see any of us in their school advocating for their rights, those are special and important moments. I just encourage you all, if you see an opportunity, to talk about your support for being a sanctuary city. If you do support, I'm not suggesting you have to, but if you do, that can be a meaningful opportunity.
Thank you. All right. Well, thank you. I know, speaking of that, and I'm trying to not make these political type speeches, but if you didn't go to the Women's March a couple of weeks ago, you really missed something, because there were so many people there that I didn't see anybody from the college that I was looking for. And yet, the next day, we all said where we were. I think we were standing next to each other and didn't even know it. But anyway, it was great. So get engaged, be active, whatever it is you stand for, do that. And encourage your students to do so, too. Thank you.